So now let's start with alcohols, okay? The last sedative and hypnotic drug, okay? Now if no alcohol is mentioned, then that alcohol means ethanol. If nothing is mentioned, then that alcohol is known as ethanol. But we will discuss certain other alcohols as well. We will write also methanol. And the third alcohol we will discuss is ethylene glycol. Okay. Now, the first point we will write that all alcohols, irrespective which type they are metabolized in our body in liver. So, they are metabolized in liver with the help of an enzyme known as dehydrogenase enzyme. So, they are metabolized by an enzyme dehydrogenase in our liver. Okay, and we don't have any specific dehydrogenase for any specific alcohol, it's same for everyone. Okay, so let's talk about when we give ethanol, methanol or ethylene glycol. First of all, the enzyme which act upon them is alcohol dehydrogenase. Okay, and this alcohol dehydrogenase convert these respective alcohols into their respective aldehydes. So, ethanol will be converted into acetaldehyde. Methanol will be converted into formaldehyde. And ethylene glycol will be converted into glycol aldehyde. Glycol aldehyde. Okay. Now, after this aldehyde, there is another enzyme which will convert them into respective acids now. So, those enzymes are known as aldehyde, they will act on this aldehyde dehydrogenase, okay, aldehyde dehydrogenase, acetaldehyde will be converted into acetic acid. Now, these acids are highly water soluble substance, acetic acid will rapidly get eliminated or excreted out in urine, okay, and methanol formaldehyde will be converted into formic acid. And glycol aldehyde will be converted into glycolic acid. And there is an enantiomer of glycolic acid which is also formed as oxalic acid. Oxalic acid. Okay. Now remember that this formic acid which is formed is highly toxic to neurons. It is highly toxic to retina. Can we say that formic acid can lead to permanent blindness in humans? That is why methanol poisoning leads to blindness. And similarly, glycolic acid is also neurotoxic. And oxalic acid can lead to oxalate stones in kidney, which can lead to renal stones. Okay, it can lead to renal stones. So, these two, methanol and ethylene glycol, are toxic alcohols. So, before coming to the treatment of the poisoning of methanol and ethylene glycol, just write one point that there is a drug which inhibits alcohol dehydrogenase enzyme in our body. The name of the drug is fomepizole. Okay, and there is a drug which inhibits aldehyde dehydrogenase. The drug name is disulfiram. This disulfiram is also known as entabuse. Okay, now I will be telling you shortly that this fomepizole will be the drug of choice for the poisoning due to methanol and ethylene glycol. It will be the drug of choice for methanol poisoning and ethylene glycol poisoning. And this disulfiram will be used in cases of ethanol to prevent alcohol or ethanol addiction. Okay. So, fomepizole, O word is coming, alcohol, dehydrogenase. Disulfiram, D word is coming, aldehyde dehydrogenase. So, let's talk about first methanol poisoning and ethylene glycol poisoning. So, let's make a heading, a very important topic, methanol poisoning. Now, the main problem with methanol poisoning is that methanol in our body, through dehydrogenase enzyme, it forms formic acid. This formic acid, remember, it is highly toxic to neurons. It is neurotoxic. Due to its neurotoxic property, remember, it damages retina, hence it may lead to permanent blindness. and also in the brain, it damages the neurons of basal ganglia. It can lead to Parkinson's disease. And as we know that formic acid is an acidic substance, it leads to metabolic acidosis. Okay. Now, let's see what is the treatment of methanol poisoning. So, for that, we will just write one mnemonic, that is SHAFE. Okay. So, the first S stands for, we give sodium bicarbonate. Sodium bicarbonate is an alkaline substance. It is given for the treatment of metabolic acidosis. Second, we will write hemodialysis. Hemodialysis is the mainstay of treatment. It is the best treatment option we have for alcohol poisoning or methanol poisoning. And hemodialysis is mandatory if the blood level of methanol is more than 20 milligram per deciliter. If it is more than 20 milligram per deciliter, it's an indication to start hemodialysis. Now, A for antidote. Now, antidote or the drug of choice for methanol poisoning is fomepizole. So, the drug of choice for methanol poisoning is fomepizole. Can you tell me why? Can we say that fomepizole inhibit alcohol dehydrogenase and hence it inhibit the formation of formic acid? So, fomepizole inhibits the formation of formic acid. Okay. F for, we also give folinic acid. Now, folinic acid will rapidly convert formic acid, which was toxic. To retina into CO2, carbon dioxide. And lastly, we give ethanol. Now, why we give ethanol? We give ethanol to saturate alcohol dehydrogenase enzyme. Okay. So that methanol will not be converted into formic acid. Okay. Now, in this mnemonic of SHAFE, if you remove this folinic acid part, that is sodium bicarbonate, hemodialysis, antidote is fomepizole and ethanol, this becomes the treatment of ethylene glycol poisoning. So, everything will be same except folinic acid. Okay. So, this becomes the treatment of ethylene glycol poisoning. Now, let's talk about ethanol. Now, ethanol is also known as only and only alcohol. And ethanol is the second most substance abuse after tobacco. So, tobacco is the most commonly abused substance. After that, there is ethanol. And ethanol shows drug addiction. The person becomes addictive to ethanol or alcohol. Okay. So, let's see how we can treat addiction of ethanol. Okay. Management or the treatment of ethanol addiction. Okay. Now, the point is, why does a person abuses any drug? There is a reason behind it. Suppose a person takes ethanol, the level of ethanol in the blood increases, and in high doses, when it goes into our brain, it produces some pleasurable response, some pleasurable effect. Like the person have loss of anxiety, person becomes more talkative. Okay. So, these effects a person usually likes. Okay. Now, the second point with any drug addiction is, as a person chronically takes alcohol, the effect of alcohol reduces. This is known as development of tolerance. Tolerance means gradual loss of effect. So, to produce that same level of pleasurable response, a person will start taking alcohol in high dose and more frequently. Okay. Now, if a person will take alcohol in high dose or more frequently, the person will become dependent on that alcohol. So, it shows dependence. So, if the body will become dependent, what will happen? till the person is having a regular supply of ethanol, the person will be happy, he will be having pleasurable response. But now, if the person is not having an alcohol, the body will go into withdrawal symptoms. The body will go into withdrawal symptoms. And these withdrawal symptoms could be dangerous. So, what are the hallmarks of drug addiction? The hallmark of drug addictions are the drug must produce a pleasurable response, the drug must show tolerance, and the drug must show dependence. And dependence can lead to withdrawal symptoms. And the symptoms of withdrawal and the symptoms of pleasurable effect are equally opposite. They both are opposite. Okay. So, let's talk about the management of alcohol addiction. How we can make a person de-addict to an alcohol? So, the first point comes, what is the management we will write? The first line management we will write is, we have to treat acute withdrawal symptoms. We have to treat acute withdrawal symptoms like delirium tremens. Delirium tremens or seizures. Now, the drug of choice for treatment of delirium tremens or seizures due to ethanol is intravenous diazepam. Intravenous diazepam. But remember, diazepam should not be given in liver failure. If the patient is having liver failure, we generally give lorazepam or oxazepam, because they are liver safe. Lorazepam and oxazepam are liver safe. Okay. But overall, drug of choice is diazepam. Okay. Now, if the patient is having psychosis, that is Korsakoff psychosis, for psychosis, we give antipsychotic drugs like intravenous haloperidol. Okay. And remember, the patient has deficiency of vitamin B1, we also give vitamin B1, that is thiamine. Okay. So, this is how we stabilize a patient who comes to us with acute withdrawal symptoms. Sometimes we also give beta blockers. Why beta blockers are given? Beta blockers are given to reduce tachycardia, to reduce anxiety. Hence, we sometimes give propranolol during acute treatment of withdrawal symptoms. Okay. Now, you have stabilized the patient. Now, as you have stabilized the patient, now we cannot send the patient directly back to the home. Because if you will send the patient after stabilization, don't you think next day again the patient can come back to you again with withdrawal symptoms? So, second line of treatment is, we have to prevent withdrawal. Now, we have to prevent withdrawal symptoms in the future, or we have to maintain de-addiction. Now, the drug of choice for preventing withdrawal is, remember, as the drug was producing pleasurable response, we don't want that the patient should have pleasurable response, and we don't want the patient to go into withdrawal. So, we have to prevent withdrawal also. Hence, we give a similarly acting sedative and hypnotic drug, which will produce effect in between, neither pleasurable response nor withdrawal. Hence, we give a similar sedative and hypnotic drug, that is benzodiazepine. The drug of choice to prevent withdrawal is chlordiazepoxide. The drug of choice to prevent withdrawal is chlordiazepoxide. It's a very long acting benzodiazepine. It's a long acting benzodiazepine, and this chlordiazepoxide is gradually tapered off, and the person will become totally free from alcohol addiction. We gradually reduce or taper off the dose, and we slowly and slowly reduce the dose, and we will withdraw chlordiazepoxide. If chlordiazepoxide is not given in the option, then you will go by the answer, that is diazepam. And both these drugs are given orally. Okay. To prevent withdrawal, the overall drug of choice is chlordiazepoxide. You can also give diazepam. Now, as you have now stopped chlordiazepoxide, anything else we want to do? The answer is yes. As now you have stopped this drug in your patient, don't you think if this patient goes to a party and their friends are drinking, don't you think that person can start drinking again? So because of this reason, we have to now give a drug which will prevent relapse. A person should not start drinking again. So the third treatment after stopping chloride epoxide, we will give a drug to prevent relapse. Relapse means a person should not start drinking again. It is also known as we have to maintain abstinence. We have to maintain abstinence. Okay. For this condition, remember, we generally give two kinds of drug. The first class of drug we will write is anti-craving drug, which will reduce the craving for alcohol. And the second drug we will write is deterrent drug. Deterrent drug means that they will create a fear among alcoholics that if they will drink alcohol, it will produce harmful side effect. Okay. So among anti-craving drug, we will write there are four drugs, that is Nota. The first drug is naltrexone. It is an opioid antagonist. It is an opioid antagonist. Remember, alcohol acts on opioid receptor as well. Second is ondansetron. It is 5-HT3 antagonist. It is a serotonin blocker. We will write topiramate. Topiramate is an AMPA blocker. It's a receptor of glutamate. And lastly, acamprosate. Acamprosate also blocks the receptor of glutamate. It is an NMDA blocker. It's an NMDA blocker. Now remember, we give the combination of naltrexone and acamprosate. Only these two drugs are approved. We give the combination of naltrexone and acamprosate. These two drugs are approved. Okay. Now as a deterrent means we will create a fear. The drug we use as a deterrent is disulfiram. Disulfiram. Disulfiram is also known as entabuse. It is also known as entabuse. Now, what is the rationale of giving disulfiram? Let's see. We know that disulfiram is an aldehyde. Disulfiram, we know, is an aldehyde dehydrogenase inhibitor. That means it will inhibit the conversion of acetaldehyde into acetic acid. So it will inhibit the conversion of acetaldehyde into acetic acid. Because of this reason, if a patient is on disulfiram, can we say that acetaldehyde will accumulate in the body? And this acetaldehyde, which accumulates in the body, it leads to various harmful effects. It leads to various harmful effects. Like, it causes flushing. It causes hypotension. It leads to chest pain. And sometimes the patient can go into shock and the patient may die. So if a person will consume alcohol, due to accumulation of acetaldehyde, unpleasant symptoms will be produced and the patient will not like the symptom. And if a patient is not liking drinking, having a pleasurable response with alcohol, the patient will say, why I'm waiting my time and money? Okay. But consuming disulfiram could be dangerous sometime because the patient can go into shock. So my question from you is, would you like to give disulfiram in those patients who are actively or chronically drinking alcohol? Or you will be giving disulfiram in those patients who have now stopped drinking alcohol? They should not start drinking. They should not start drinking again. So remember, disulfiram is only given to prevent relapse. A person should not start drinking again. And disulfiram is absolutely contraindicated in chronic active drinkers. Disulfiram is absolutely contraindicated in chronic active drinkers because it can lead to unpleasant symptoms. And these symptoms, which are produced by disulfiram, are known as disulfiram-like reactions. Okay? Disulfiram-like reaction. Now, the point with them is that there are certain drugs in our subject or pharmacology which also produce disulfiram-like reaction. So, let's make a heading. Disulfiram-like reactions. That means there are certain drugs which can inhibit acetaldehyde dehydrogenase or aldehyde dehydrogenase, one and the same thing. So, can we say that these drugs should not be given in chronic active alcoholics who are actively drinking alcohol? These drugs should not be given, they must be avoided. So, let's write the list of the drugs which show disulfiram like reaction. The first drug we will write is metronidazole. Okay, it's an antibacterial drug. Second, we will write griseofulvin. It's an antifungal drug. Third drug we will write is procarbazine. Procarbazine is an anti-cancer drug. These three drugs are very commonly asked. Now, what are the other drugs? We will write chlorpropamide. Chlorpropamide, it's an anti-diabetic drug. Clofibrate, hypolipidemic drug. Carbamazepine and cyclophosphamide, another anti-cancer drug, and lastly certain cephalosporins. Certain cephalosporins, they also show disulfiram like reaction, like cefoparazone, cefamendol and cefotetan. Cefotetan. So, they show disulfiram-like reaction. Okay. So, this is about alcohol de-addiction, and this completes our sedative and hypnotic. So, thank you very much. I hope you liked it. So, I'm Dr. Ankit. Enjoy the series.